gives me great pleasure to introduce Hugo Rodier. He's back by popular demand. We always, people come out of sessions with Hugo when he's been speaking, and they're just buzzing with energy and excitement. So we're glad to have you back, Hugo. Hugo is besides a popular presenter, he's an author. He has several books for sale out on the registration table. He's a radio talk show host. He is an activist. He's gotten involved in the past in not only medical or health issues, but environmental toxicity. I think the very first time I ever attended one of Hugo's sessions, I was struck with the term leaky gut, which is a term he uses a lot. And it didn't occur to me that you had to do more than just put good nutrition into your body. You also have to have a gut ready to receive it and use it. So that made an impression on me. As I looked into more about Hugo, he was born in Chile. He has paternal roots in France. And so that's given him kind of a unique ability to have insight into different cultures. He speaks Spanish and French. And says you read, do you still read 100 medical journals a month? That's incredible. I haven't any idea what hermetic health means other than that's how you seal something airtight, so I hope you'll tell us what that means. And I'm delighted and excited to have you here. Thank you, Hugo. I invite you up to the front.
Good morning. My wife tried to talk me out of using that name, Hermetic Health. She said, Hugo, they're going to think you're going to talk about hermaphrodites and sex and stuff. I said, listen, you watch the Kardashians too much. It's an illustrated approach, so I advise you to relax and watch the slides fly by and then study the content at home. Hermes, as you know, is this guy here. He holds the caduceus, the symbol of the medical profession. And as you all know, because you've watched the Da Vinci Code and perhaps read all the books, symbolism has a whole lot to offer. And so this will be a highly symbolic discussion. There are the goals that they told me to write down, but my main goal is to get out of here alive. Because you might think this is a little heavy on philosophy and beliefs, but we all have them, and I just think that perhaps we should share them from time to time, and I hope I do it in a way that it's not offensive. This is a disease. It's been recognized as a disease, the Ionian enchantment, and I confess that I have it. It's the only thing I share with Nobel Prize winners who tend to think that everything is connected, and I mean everything. So I never go off the subject because it's all connected. And I admire people who are able to think with both sides of the brain, as Einstein. I love quoting this, the most beautiful emotion is the sensation of the mystical. It is the power of all true science. That's what the greatest mind of the 20th century said. I also like this. I love to simplify things. So you might think it's too simplistic at the end, but that is my goal. I love Deutsch. How many of you have read Deutsch, David Deutsch? You have a treat coming. Pick up Fabric of Reality first, then this one. It's a treatise on logics, and Deutsch will say that the certainty of science and the lack of precision of philosophy are mistaken arguments. I agree. So I wish to balance all these things. So if I sound too philosophical, I invite you to check out my website, where you will see that on a monthly basis, I go through 100 medical journals to edit a newsletter, a little too heavy on references, because we have to do it that way. I believe that The complexity that we are burdened with in our systems, particularly medicine, is an illusion. And these people agree. So look it up and study the whole issue. About five very good articles on saying that once we strike at the root of things, particularly medicine, things become quite simple. I also believe that competition in from one field to another is a fallacy. Scientific American and many other thinkers are saying that if we don't learn to cooperate, we're done for. So the myth of Darwinian competition is dying. Avatars from the beginning of mankind has told us the same, that things are very simple and must be balanced. It's no accident that there were two ruffians and one avatar in the center, as you will see. A belief held throughout the world. Of course, the Buddhists are the best known for emphasizing the middle way or the balanced way. And that is exactly what the caduceus means. When you first look at it, you might think FTD floral. But if you look deeper, you'll see astounding meaning. First of all, you have two snakes in balance, feather snakes. Turns out that the bird and the snake have been with us since the Garden of Eden. Egyptians use that on their crown, the bird and the snake. Many will say, oh, that was Upper and Lower Egypt. No, there's more meaning than that. Here's Thoth, another name for Hermes. Thoth here holding the caduceus to resurrect a dead man. In the right hand, he holds the Ankh, a cross symbolizing life or the renewal of life. And if you think this is a bit too Eastern, the quest for the Holy Grail is symbolized by a feather serpent as well. Turns out that the snake has been long a symbol of energy, and the bird a symbol of information. Also, as above, so below. The bird above, the snake below. A symbol that many countries have on their flags, like Mexico. And so, why is it that we have adopted in the medical profession this such a powerful symbol? A symbol that has become, that is worshipped as deity throughout the world. The Chinese dragon is a flying serpent. And look how many cultures hold Hermes or Mercury in such high regards. It's all the same guy. And for people who love the Bible and feel that that's all there is, I respect that very much. Well, it turns out that Enoch is Hermes, same guy. But look at the symbol closer. A snake eating its own tail and a dove, a symbol of renewal, the Ouroboros. That all life renews itself. All life is about energy and information to renew itself from the earth to our very atoms. We have 10 billion cells in the human body, all of which we lose a day. We have 100 trillion cells in the human body. We lose 10 billion cells a day to be replaced by 10 billion new cells. And so this is highly symbolic of how our bodies work and the whole universe, all built on energy and information for renewal, the dance of Shiva. We first learn of these ideas in the West from the Medici, the doge of Florence, or the top guy, felt that they needed to get a hold of the Book of Thoth, or the Book of Hermes. Back in those days, as you know, the time of the Medici was a time of Renaissance. So you might ask, what triggered the Renaissance? This book here. Actually, it's 42 books. 36 of which are written about medicine. This is why we get the word medicine. From where we get the word medicine, from the Medici in Renaissance Florence. And this book triggered the Renaissance with all the knowledge that it contains. It's very simple. The very foundation of the 42 books is the Emerald Tablet. Have you heard of that, anyone? The Emerald Tablet, a couple of people. Well, it's about Hermes, the message of Hermes. I already mentioned a few. Everything is light, creation, destruction, that God is in nature, as our Native American brother, I'm sure, would agree. He took off. Everything is one consciousness. It's all one concept. Very simple. And you might be thinking, what does this have to do with science? Well, I'm going there. Let's just start from the beginning. That's pretty much the beginning right there. Light. A point of light exploded, the Big Bang Theory, to create everything in its wake. But we find that in Genesis as well. Light is the beginning of all creation. And luminaries like Einstein pretty much agree. You can find many articles on physics right now, but everything in the whole universe is light, which is composed of energy and information. Light is energy and information. And that's exactly what the caduceus means, a snake and a bird, energy and information. Einstein, I have to go back to him. Many people dissecting his brain feel that his brilliancy laid in a bigger, thicker corpus callosum, which is how we integrate both sides of the brain, the right and the left brain. And so a whole lot of physicists right now are beginning to see that our ancient brothers, with their symbology, knew all these things already. And so you can read any one of these books. I love The Fabric of Reality. Look at Schrodinger here. You know, that's a guy that talks about the cat in the box, right? Well, he famously said that life is nothing but the ability to use energy and information. And so the ancients, let's review what they said, and corroborated by modern physics, that from below to above, it's all the same thing. Energy and information. And so here's Thoth again, holding the Ankh in his hand. Pretty symbolic. To me, that means that everything about life, the cycles of life, are fueled by energy and information. A Celtic Christ symbolizes the same thing. The cross pretty much is a Sumerian symbol, way before Christians, which means as above, so below, and the energy of the sun. If you like the Bible, well, here's St. John the Baptist and St. John the Evangelist. Quite symbolic. St. John the Baptist, information. St. John the Baptist, information. St. John the Evangelist, St. John the Baptist, energy. St. John the Evangelist, information. Look at the bird. The Essenes, a branch of people who lived in Palestine at the time of Christ, their other name for Essene was physician or healer. And so all this can be translated into the simple fact that everything about life, and we are rooted to Mother Earth, is the energy and information that comes from the sun. Through photosynthesis, we're able to harness that energy and information, which then becomes us. And messing with all that can lead to a whole lot of problems. So, food then can be viewed as energy and information. We are beings of light. Think about it. And so this is exactly what the luminaries of medicine have said, Hippocrates and William Osler, energy and information. To renew those 10 billion cells each day and to fuel everything we need to do with that body. And so it all boils down to how those 100 trillion cells talk to one another. They send each other messages. The last Nobel Prize was on cell communication. So this 100 trillion cells talk to one another with the sole purpose of bringing energy and information to each one of those 100 trillion cells. And so before I go into health, let me tell you how this very simple concept of energy and information and a balance thereof permeates all knowledge. All knowledge. And the ultimate goal of such knowledge is not just to be prideful and show how much we know. The goal of knowledge, in my opinion, is simply stated. What does that mean? Know thyself. And once we know ourselves, once we understand our true identity, we cannot fail but to do good and be respectful and loving to other people. So it all begins in India. Agni, Utra, Mitra. Energy, information, balance thereof. So this is where we see the caduceus for the first time, in India. And if you study anthropology, you know the Egyptians got everything they knew from India. Look at Mitra, the symbol of balance. Feather serpent. Heat, energy, information. The wings of the bird. Then all that knowledge went to Buddha, who, of course, emphasized Mitra. Balance of energy and information. The Egyptians picked up on all that, and they revere the sun disk, energy, information, the bird and the snake. The Jewish people, after captivity, picked up on all these things, so they based their whole view of life on the Temple of Solomon, very symbolic, with two pillars, Boaz and Jochim. As above, so below, energy and information. And so their Kabbalah tree has three pillars, energy, information, balance in the middle. They called it strength, wisdom, and harmonia, harmonia for balance. Oh, there's so much on that. Harmonia Mundi, Kepler, the music of the spheres. This Greek failed democracy, he took off to Egypt. You can read about that from Plato. He discovered two pillars sunk in the ocean. And then we start to get Western philosophy, as above, so below, Plato, Aristotle. Plato, philosophy, Aristotle, science. Are they fighting? No, says Raphael. Let's just put them together. On this side, all the people who think with the left brain. On this side, the people who think with the right brain. Who's right, who's wrong? No, it's a matter of balance of both. And that's exactly what the Ionic column in architecture tells us. Balance of strength and wisdom. The Christians, as I mentioned already, took a lot from the Essenes, who lived in the town of syringes, and their practice was called therapeutics. And this is what they preached. Be wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove. Then we come to Western philosophy, and this is back then, so don't take any offense, okay? Catholicism, energy, the snake. Protestantism, information, but balance, the Hermetics, which have been shut out of the picture. So we don't hear much about them. But here's Mercury, the caduceus, symbol of balance, Mercury. The sun, the moon. The ancients talked about the planets quite a bit. Modern philosophers agree. I hope you get a chance to read this book, one of my top five. Kierkegaard, the symbol of balance in Western thinking. And in scientific terms and medical terms, we call it the law of tolerance, the laws of balance, Hermes. And then comes Newton, and we all think of him as this great physicist. Well, check out the BBC. He was the last of the magicians, deeply immersed in hermetics and alchemy. And look at your computer. We're using everything you're watching right now is ones and O's, right? In a balanced way. Energy and information, male and female. Did you know that many people think that the true origin of the word America, America with a U, is the land of the feather serpent? And of course, you know, you wouldn't know about balance. I'm not a Democrat nor a Republican, but are we balanced? Are we balanced in our healthcare system? You know, economics is nothing but the management of money, right? Which is a symbol of energy and information. There's another feather serpent for you. How many of you saw that movie? It's the same with economics, energy and information. I love this book, How We Need to Simplify Economics. And John Adams was famous for saying that people cannot be free until they understand how money operates. Then psychology. These two guys, they fought each other quite a bit, as you know, Jung and Freud. And did you see this movie? Great book. Jung and Freud. You know, I love this book. A true story how these two guys were in love with a woman who pretty much inspired both of them, but neither one recognized her or gave her credit for the ideas they took from her. I like this psychologist much better. I think he was a whole lot more balanced than the two we just talked about. And then anthropology. This is who we are. My wife would agree with that. In another sense. And so the rebus, the ancients knew that all the universe is a balance of male and female forces, as are we. And the Rosicrucians made a meal out of that. So who are we? I think before we get to know who we truly are, we must balance the mind and the heart, just like Deutsch said, the certainty of science and the lack of precision of philosophy are mistaken arguments. How many of you have Googled that, the little brain and the heart? We're finding that our heart has a brain, that we know things way before we think them, that the heart knows. This is an amazing book saying that the heart has 5,000 times more energy than the brain. So I love this book. This is my top one, number one book. How many of you have read The Little Prince? Oh, half the room. That feels good. Then you know what I mean. So really, who are we? As our Native American brother would agree, we're products of Mother Earth. That's why I'm an environmentalist. You know, 30 years ago, I, working with the UMA, I began to say that dirty air was bad for you. I got stoned to death. Sorry, I had to throw that in. Look at the symbol of Mother Earth. Does it look familiar? It's a caduceus. So, health. It's coming. You'll love this. So what is stress? What is the loss of health? The loss of balance? The loss of homeostasis? That's what homeostasis means, balance, harmony. And that's the most accepted definition of health, harmony, balance, which is symbolized by the cross. And the loss of homeostasis can be symbolized by excessive vertical thinking. We keep dwelling on thoughts all the time, even the past and then the future, and never deal horizontally with our thoughts, one thought at a time. And so that's another reason I love William James, how stress is mostly an inability to control our thoughts. And then they begin to impact the adrenal glands. And then you know it's all downhill from there. So that is what the ancients have maintained all along, that the third pillar, the pillar of balance, of harmony, is a balance between strength and wisdom, energy and information, the left, the right, the Democrats and Republicans, male, female, energy and information for us today. And so how ironic that many medical societies throughout the country are thinking to switch from the Caduceus to the Rod of Asclepius. Do you see the irony? Yeah. Because this is a balanced system. This is not. It's all about strength. Strength that refuses to see the wisdom of the feminine. Guys, I'm not talking about women here. I'm talking about all of us, okay? So don't get mad at me. And so, with all due respect to all the emergency room people, the ICU people, and you know, while we lollygag here, they're up to here and muck and blood and saving people. That's what our healthcare system is based on. And I love it. We have the best emergency healthcare system in the world. And thanks to those people toiling out there, we're able to sit here and talk about fun things. So I'm very grateful for those physicians and nurses and practitioners who are practicing acute care medicine. But I'm sorry, I just don't see any wisdom or balance in the chronic healthcare system, which continues to treat the symptoms of problems without addressing the root issues that I've been talking about. And we knew this would happen. Do you know this guy? Flexner, the Flexner Report over 100 years ago. He modeled the whole healthcare system after the German system, which we needed to do, no question about it. Because there were some people getting MD degrees from diploma mills. William Osler sounded the alarm. He said, look, guys, we need to do this, yes, but don't forget about the right side of the brain, the humanities, the human touch of medicine. And so here we come to health again. This is the best medicine. Energy and information for healing in a balanced way. And so you're going to have a talk about healthy aging, and that's what the journals are saying. This is what we should be focusing on. Healthy aging. And you can read that at home. And so what is aging about? How we use energy at the cellular level. How we use energy and information from food primarily. And then we can replace those 10 billion cells in a more effective way every day. And look at how many things impinge on how we use energy and information. Most people are shocked to see that the gut flora we carry has a huge role in how we use energy and information. You and I could eat the same amount of calories, but if my gut flora is messed up, I will gain weight and you won't. So much for calories in, calories out. If you're still thinking that, you need to read the journals. And so beyond calories, we all have different gas mileages, just like those cars out there. And so I say, we fix our gut, we fix how we process energy and information, everything starts to get better. That's what the journalists are saying. Please, go to the evidence. And so it all begins with each cell. They have a skin around them, the cell membrane, made up of food, fat, proteins, and sugar, and a bilayer, much like a computer. And so when that cell membrane is not in good health, when it toils, when it's toxic, oxidized, inflamed, and has less than optimal mitochondrial function, that cell membrane will not allow energy and information to enter the cell to reprogram itself, to heal itself, to function. We wouldn't be here in this room without energy and information. No society can function without them. It's as above, so below. The T is for toxicity. I wish I had more time for that, but turns out that the gut and the liver are key, and most of our patients' gut and liver are just not that functional. Oxidation, you know all about that. So that's why the micronutrients in our food are so important, but we're losing a whole lot of them because of food processing and depletion of soils. I for inflammation, who doesn't know that everything is, every disease is an inflammatory condition, even cancer. I love that word, meta-inflammation, metabolic inflammation. It tells you everything. We oxidize, we get inflamed because we use energy, just like your engine. The L for the lack of mitochondrial function, the mitochondria itself, it's a cell within a cell, and on its own cell membrane is where it phosphorylates to make energy from the food we eat. And just about every disease has been linked to a faulty mitochondrial function because its cell membrane is so delicate. That's why they made a pact, the systemic cells with the mitochondria. We'll go inside, we'll give you energy, but you gotta protect us. Well, if the big cell, the body cell, is already dysfunctional, the mitochondria will not be that protected. The L also stands for loneliness and lack of love. And I wish I had more time on that, but your conference has many speakers on the brain or the mind-body connection. So here's our main health problem, insulin resistance. Another way of saying that energy and information cannot enter the cell to properly fuel them, the slippery slope to all diseases. And then every terrain, every organ, every surface begins to toil, T-O-I-L, toxicity, oxidation, inflammation, less than optimal mitochondrial function, thereby triggering leaky surfaces. And you're all familiar with leaky gut. But what's amazing is that most people don't know we also have leaky arteries. It's the same thing. And with leaky arteries, you start to have problems with the distribution of energy and information to all the cells. And what goes up to fix your leaky arteries? Does anybody know? Cholesterol. As God intended. I'll just leave it at that. And then we have a faulty brain-gut connection. And who hasn't heard about the brain-gut connection? And then cancer itself is poor energy, poor information. But we're told that it's our genes causing the cancer. No, cancer is 80 to 90% environmental. Yeah, our DNA is taking a beating. You think it's a coincidence that it looks like that? And so epigenetics, I'm sure you've heard about epigenetics by now, right? Epigenetics. Above genetics. What is above genetics? Your environment, the food you eat. So you and I could have bad genes, genetics, but if I eat real well, I'll dodge those genetic bullets. But you might not if you eat poorly. So, yeah, speak of genes, we're devolving. And so here it is, in a nutshell, your DNA. Weakest link. Mine is arthritis. Yours might be heart attacks. Yours, cancer. The same stressors. I get arthritis. You get heart attacks. Food is the best medicine. Read this at home. Solvay coagula. The ancients loved to say that. Analyze and synthesize. And that's what I've been trying to do as I go through these slides quickly. And a refresher, Marginot, great book, saying that if you want to know reality, you must look for answers that are simple, connect everything, look at the root of things, and are elegant. Echoed by this journal again, and Occam's razor. Occam's razor, as you know, when things are really complicated, the simplest solution is probably the correct one. And here it is, the most practical solution. But can you eat that way? Based on fruits, veggies, and nuts? I'm not saying meat is terrible, but it should be eaten in moderation. And in secret, I tell my patients that the best is being vegetarian, but I'm not gonna go there. Because most people are having trouble with one simple thing, their addiction to sugar. That must be tackled first. And then we start to heal our gut, the root to Mother Earth. And I tell you, our journals are being flooded with articles on how important the gut is, which incidentally is your immune system. Yes, a whole lot of things are happening in the gut. And you know, we've known this since 1908, when these very concepts won the Nobel Prize. And you can see a revival, if you will, of all these wonderful concepts. Lots of articles. I wrote a book about all this. Did you know that the genes in our gut flora outnumber our genes 150 to 1? And so the main thing is to eat the glycemic index diet, the Mediterranean diet. And I like to help people with other things because, see, they're caught in a vicious cycle. If the gut is not functioning properly, leaky gut and all that, how are they going to absorb the nutrients? So it's a little bit tricky. So I do believe in some supplements. The main thing is to rest the gut for a few days so it begins to heal and improve absorption. Drugs, yes, I use some antibiotics at times because some of the people are colonized by really bad bacteria. From what? From excessive antibiotics, from the purple pill. Yeah, the purple pill. I don't want to go there. It's too many problems. Although you do need it if you have an ulcer and you're bleeding, they'll give it to you IV up a hill, and as they should. But a whole lot of, I'm sure you've heard this before at this conference. Most pharmaceuticals come from Mother Nature because they tap into the receptors of our cells that have been there for millennia to harness energy and information. And so the main obstacle when I see patients is their addiction to sugar. So I tell them about the science of glycobiology, how even our kids are addicted. That's my dad's bistro, a Frenchman who loved good food. There's this little bistro by a McDonald's. Not even flies check out my dad's food. General Nature and many other journals are saying how addicting sugar is, as harmful as tobacco. But you know what? Don't bother trying to tell your kids to quit eating sugar or school programs which are failing on how to eat better, because this is the problem. We're subsidizing the makers of sugar with their own tax money. It's a political economic issue. We're very inactive. we're finding that a lot of people being inactive is worse than drinking and smoking. So the article's on activity. A quick tip. If you sit for 30 minutes, you must get up for two. So at work, get your own damn coffee. Well, here's the solution. 80-20, number comes up a whole lot. Yes, some people will need medication, and I welcome it if used correctly. But whatever you do, don't end up like Sisyphus, pushing that rock uphill. It comes back, it comes back. And number three, huge in symbolism. So, best to address the roots, energy and information, which this good doctor does. Landmark article, titled Promoting More Conservative Prescribing. One, seek non-drug alternatives first, rather than last resort. Two, treat the underlying causes rather than treat the symptoms. Simple answers will be the future of healthcare. This article and that article say that. By the year 2020, medicine will be integrative based on cellular function. You see, the healthcare system right now only tackles 90% of the factors that influence people's health. Excuse me, I said it backwards. The healthcare system right now accounts for only 10% of the factors that lead to disease. The other 90% is what you have come here to learn about. So integrative health, in my mind, is a homeostasis, the balance of energy and information. And it's all based on metabolism, how we metabolize at the cellular level. And so with these simple ideas, we all seek to empower patients so that they can become the future king and queen. Self-efficacy, I'm sure most of you have read that book, How People Get Better When They're Empowered. I know Buzz likes to call all this resilience, right? A Roman principle, if you want to keep people governed so that they don't cause too many waves, give them bread and circus. Does it sound familiar? Cheap food, cheap entertainment. There's a better Roman principle. Salus populi, suprema lex. The health of the people is the supreme law of the land. As much as I like these guys, I think the picture is a little bit flawed. Do you see what's missing? Women, thank you. You know, I have to tell you a story from Dr. Nelson. He used to be president of the UMA and then became president of the AMA. Does anyone know Dr. Nelson? He's retired now. Well, he told me a story and I asked him if I could share it. As an intern, he had to pronounce a man dead in the hospital for the first time. And if you're a doctor, that's a harrowing experience. My first time, I was very shook up. So was Dr. Nelson and the wife, the poor wife by the bed. So poor Dr. Nelson didn't know what to do after pronouncing the man. So he hugged the women and they cried in each other's arms. Well, the chief resident happens to go by and sees that. So when Dr. Nelson leaves the room, the resident dressed him down for acting like a woman. What a beautiful picture. You see how they're holding babies? I love nurses. I think they bring so much to the medical profession. And the bottom line is that we cooperate, that we bring energy and information to bear, again, in cooperation, simple principles to put patients back at the center of healthcare. And thus, we can become Hermes, Enoch, Idris, Thoth, Mercury, Quetzalcoatl, ourselves. And then we become seraphims. The symbol of seraphim, the caduceus. The ancients revered this igni natura renovatur integra. They felt it was the essence of who we are. Translated, the fire of nature renovates everything. Energy and information, strength and wisdom and harmony. And so I always have to throw this in because it sounds a lot quite serious, you know, but it shouldn't be. I love the laughing Buddha. I love to understand suffering. Suffering is to help us understand who we truly are. Suffering and humor and balance. And so in conclusion, I say no to transhumanism, and that's another discussion for the future. Yes to becoming like Hermes, balance of energy and information, like those columns in harmony. Know thyself. Thank you very much. Is there time for questions? I think we have 15 minutes.
15 minutes.
Yep. Any questions?
Is there going to be a test?
Yes.
Just go ahead and raise your hand if you have a question.
They're stunned into silence. Yes, please.
What would you say are some of the greatest works that have been done on the addiction with sugar?
Mm. My book. Am I allowed to say that?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Check out my website. I've dedicated my whole career to that. And this is the main thing that I can tell you. We're looking at an addiction as powerful as tobacco and alcohol. So to go into schools and tell people eat broccoli, it's like telling an alcoholic drink water. So I think the solution to the whole problem must be public health and psychology. Doctors are overwhelmed. These poor docs, you know, all they can do is hand you a quick medication, and there's no discussion on what's going on. So my patients, I spend a long time just lollygagging, talking, and trying to motivate people. I ask for follow-ups. I have a nutritionist in my practice. And so it's not easy. And look, all the work, save yourself the trouble. All the work that people have done on addiction medicine, take it and translate it to sugar. Is that powerful in addiction? It messes with your gut flora. That's one of the biggest things that sugar does. So you start to have and encourage the growth of bad organisms who got used to all that sugar, and they put out metabolites or messages that go to the brain saying, feed me sugar, feed me sugar, feed me sugar, and there you go. I dedicated my book to moms who are struggling with their kids' sugar addiction. And so I tell you, if I solved all that, I'd win the Nobel Prize. So look, just look at addiction medicine. That's what we need to do, in my opinion. Yes, please. You know, yeah. You know, as much as I make noise and I am a bit of an activist, I still think that Gandhi is the right approach. It's going to happen because it's true, because it must happen. So the more we fight the forces of masculinity, the worse it gets. And so I believe in a more accepting approach, and it will happen. Now, the activist don't like to hear that because they like change now. I think things are the way they are for a reason. And look, a dirty little secret. Who's the power behind the king in chess? Does anybody know? The queen. So look, guys who really know, they know who's in charge. Any other question? Yes, please.
Can you clarify the as above, as below? Because I read that
yes.
Yes.
Kind of, well, it means that everything here on earth It's patterned after the skies. Now, whether you believe that means the planets or a preexistence or God himself or consciousness, it's all the same. It's all one ball of wax. It's like oatmeal. You know, say you make oatmeal, and it's all oatmeal, but you got a lump here and another lump there because you didn't stir it very well. And how ludicrous would it be for one lump to say to the other, hey, you're different, we're separate, we're different people. So everything at the universe levels, how the planets operate, it's the same thing as the atomic level and us in between, our human cells. In fact, I gotta tell you this, I gave a talk last week and I'm still buzzing with what happened last month, the 11th, in the journal Physics Review Letters. Does anybody know? Gravitational waves were discovered. This had such a big impact that the journal Science rerun the article the 19th of last month. What does that mean, that we've discovered gravitational waves? I mean, you might be thinking, what's this guy talking about? This is, it's a fabric of reality, it's what I just told you. It's all one ball of wax. The easiest way to explain it is, say the guys in the back pick up a blanket, and the guys up front here will pick up the other end, and the same on the sides. Big blanket. That's the fabric of reality. Put a bowling ball in the middle. You know what's going to happen. Now I'm going to pick up a golf ball here. That's gravity. Because that bowling ball, the lump of oatmeal, is deforming the fabric of reality, the oatmeal, to the point where gravitational waves are created. They're not really gravitational in the sense that we've understood it. It's just a blip in the fabric of space causing the golf ball to go down. You know, Newton, the biggest mind that has influenced how we flew to the moon and how we operate even now, because we haven't really understood Einstein, said, and he symbolized it by an apple hitting him on the head, that he understood gravity. Yeah, this is what it is, things fall. But he admitted he didn't know what caused it. Well, we found out last month. And the apple, why did he pick an apple? Because it's very symbolic. It's a symbol of creation. Any other question? Yes?
I'm curious because you read extensively and you dive deeply into thought about all of this and you treat patients. What do you practice in your own life?
Don't go to lunch with them.
I eat veggies for breakfast. I throw in a little quinoa, brown rice, organic chicken once in a while, organic fish once in a while, leftovers for lunch and a very light dinner, nuts, a sandwich, whole grains, a lot of juices, pomegranate, green tea, suja, or suja is kale juice. I'm 63 years old. I don't feel like it. And I tell you, I need to preach. I need to show people what I preach. So it's all about nutrition. I hope you come and see me. Thank you very much.